All right. Hello and welcome. What I want to talk to you about today is how you would put together a course-based undergraduate research experience looking at using plants to clean up metals from mine soils. This was the phytoremediation undergraduate research experience that I developed here at ASU West, and I think it's a really fun way to introduce students to science as well as try to get them interested in ways to clean up the environment. So, how do these kind of projects start? I know a lot of you are probably thinking, wow, I don't know anything about how plants clean up metals. I don't know what plants could be used. This really sounds like a lot of work. It's not, because what you want to do is you want to get your students to do the work. So let's imagine you were trying a phytoremediation course with your students. The first thing you want to do is actually begin to select candidate plants that would be useful in your situation. Now, in our situation, we were looking at plants that remediated metals pollution from mining. The history of Arizona has a large amount of hard rock mining in it. If you weren't aware of it, Arizona is probably one of the world's largest sources of mined copper. So this is a real interest to us in local issues. But how do you start that? What I recommended to the students is, and what I based my first cure on, was actually having them test different plants to see if they could tolerate germination in soils or in water that had been spiked with metals. So what we did in that case, is we used some petri dishes, right? We've got a few plastic ones here for you. And then what I did for these, and this is a real common germination experiment. Many of you have probably done something similar to this in other labs. But we go ahead and place, these filters are a little big, so I'm gonna put them in the top. Go ahead and place, I'm gonna go ahead and do three of these for you so you can see how I set them up. All right, so now what you're gonna do is you're gonna wanna pick candidate species that you think would be good for remediation. But the thing is the professor, you shouldn't pick them. You should actually build that first cure experience in a way that asks your students, well, what plants would be best? And one of the best ways that you can actually test that is germination. So germination is one of the real important events in a plant's life. It's when it breaks out of its seed as an embryo to become an adult. It's also one of the places where the plant is most sensitive to environmental contaminants. So one of the ways you can start working a research experience like this is the first semester you run it, you ask the students to focus their questions on what plants would be good candidates to remediate whatever problem you're looking at. And so as you see here, I've set up three petri dishes with filter paper in them. We're going to add a little bit of water to each of those, just enough to get the petri dish wet. And then I actually have here some spare seeds from one of my other research projects, cucumber seeds. Not necessarily recommending them for this kind of work, but I'm not saying they're bad. This is, again, something that is great to explore with your students. So what we're going to do, I'm going to put, I like numbers that make the math easier. So I'm going to put 10 seeds in each of these petri dishes. Let's get them in the third one. All right. So you noticed I put a little water in. One of the great ways to set this experiment up to look at toxicity is instead of just using DI water like I did, your students could use solutions with gradually increasing levels of whatever contaminant you're looking at. If we were looking here in Arizona at copper, I might have, I would have the student set up an experiment so there were different levels of copper in that water so that then they could see if those seeds germinate. So once you get that water in, you get the seeds in, you get the filters together, you're gonna go ahead and put the lids on the petri dish. So once you've gotten the seeds into the petri dishes with your solution and the like, this last step you wanna take is you wanna grab some parafilm and you wanna seal the petri dish up. The reason for this, and especially here, in Phoenix, the reason for this is if you don't seal the petri dish up, it's going to dry out and you're going to lose, I think I need a bigger piece of film there. You're going to lose your experiment. So this is probably the most important part initially, is to make sure that parafilm wraps the petri dish, right? There. All right. So now you're going to let that sit. Typically, I let those sit a week because the way the course works here at ASU's West Campus is we meet once a week. Next week, the students would look at them for percent germination. What you can also do, though, in a situation like this is let's imagine you get 100% germination across the entire study, right? All of your controls, all of your experimental. The students are going to be really concerned because they don't have good data. One of the neat things about leaving this petri dish for a week and letting the seeds germinate is that you're not going to have so much biomass that it's hard to measure. And so you can actually have students measure the shoot length or the radical, which is the embryonic root tip length, and look at those. When I was doing this particular experiment, is actually based off of previous work I did building an ecology lab here at Arizona State University's West Campus. And in that ecology lab, I had that exact same problem, is we had germination occur across the board. But what I was able to show the students is that the controls had germinated sooner and therefore had grown larger. And that significant difference was enough to save that experiment. So that's something that really is gives you a little bit more of an option when you're looking at testing with seeds. Now, besides testing with seeds, a lot of your students are going to want to actually grow plants. And there's a pretty quick and straightforward way to grow those plants to do this kind of testing. So what I have here is parts from a kit sold by Ward's for a plant called rapid radishes. And these rapid radishes have been selected to go through a life cycle in as little as 30 days. So one of the other techniques a number of my student groups have used is to take some sort of potting soil. I've got an example of vermiculite here, right? And the nice thing about these seeds is, again, if you use the kinds of planters that usually come with them, that usually come from Ward's, you get large numbers of replicates. One of the real important things that I like to emphasize in my research classes is statistical significance and number of replicates. So again, in this situation, you can go ahead and mix your soil. I didn't bring any out today because I don't need to make that big of a mess, but you can mix your soil. What a number of my students did is actually mix the contaminant of interest, in this case metals, into the soils, placing the soils in there. Obviously, you'd probably want to use the same level of contamination for each tray, since there'd be a problem of it mixing in, and especially given that these trays are designed to capture the water beneath and hold it there, which basically is a real advantage in terms of making sure that your plants don't dry out. Now, with an experiment like this, you can not only look at germination rate, but you can actually look at above ground biomass, below ground biomass. And if you're able to do so, you could even take those plants after they've grown and sample them to see if metals are inside of them. And that would use the X-ray fluorescence detector that I want to talk about in a future video. But all of those are ways to work in the laboratory to basically set up the beginning parameters of what you should envision as a long-term research project. And what I mean by that is that each of your cures should build on the previous so that students can actually get an idea of this continuum of knowledge being built and understand more the process of science and how it really is a collaboration across generations. Well, that's what I wanted to talk to you about lab techniques. Thank you for watching.